This week on Maker Update, hot glue at Mach 2, making visual effects shots with cheap toys, long Pong, shop tips, and a $500 cinema camera. Hello and welcome back to Maker Update, the show where we keep you all caught up on the cool stuff that makers are making. I'm Tyler Weingartner, and I hope you're all doing great. We've got an awesome show with a little bit of a filmmaking theme with all this week's projects and tips, but don't panic. It all ties back to making. First things first, though, let's check out the project of the week. Sometimes you get to working on a project out of pure inspiration. Sometimes you push through a project because you were hired for it. And sometimes you come up with a project just because you're mad. That's how Xyla Foxlin set out to create this all-carbon fiber rocket capable of reaching Mach 2 called Spite. I'll let her tell the story of how she got inspired to pursue this project, but rest assured, it's a good one. Unfortunately, it's not all the focus of the video. What is how she designed and constructed this rocket that's almost all motor. That's why it's able to achieve the speeds and altitudes that it can. If you take anything away from this video, it's that working with composites like carbon fiber is a lot easier than most people think. To create the fins for the rocket, all she's doing is wetting down several layers of carbon fiber with epoxy, and then compressing them together while they cure, after adding two external peel-away sheets for extra texture. The other great takeaway from this project is creating and maintaining a rigid schedule, and one that also gives you time for much needed breaks. This entire rocket was built in just 3 weeks, and you can be assured that not everything went perfect, and there were a lot of late nights and fast sleeps. But giving yourself those breaks is a great way to avoid burnout and keep the momentum going. The video culminates with a rocket launch at the Friends of Amateur Rocketry site in the Mojave Desert. The launch went off as a complete success, and she was able to hit all the numbers she was reaching for. The rocket speed peaked at Mach 2.3 and an altitude of 23,000 feet, her highest and fastest rocket launch yet. This is a really fun video that's chock full of rocket jargon, engineering tips, and a few fun visual gags. Don't miss out on it. More projects. From Look Mom No Computer comes Long Pong. Like the name suggests, this is a game of Pong, but with an ultra-wide display made of several LED matrices chained together. Those matrices have an interesting story behind them. They're the Galactic Unicorn matrix sold by Pimoroni. But since Pimoroni only likes to sell the very best products they can, these are all the B-stock. Boards with slight defects, or maybe where not all the LEDs light up totally perfect. The other amazing thing about this project is that Sam didn't actually make it. It was built by a group of people at his museum. Once he had all the matrices from Pimoroni, they needed a project and formed a group around it. And a bunch of the code was even contributed remotely by folks from the Look Mom No Computer Discord server. The code runs on a Raspberry Pi, and it doesn't just play Pong either. There's a number of ultra-wide games and demos you could run on this thing. But the real takeaway here is not trying to do every single project by yourself. Find your maker squad and let them help you build more weird projects. From the filmmaking channel FilmRiot, I found this video about recreating visual effects shots using toy miniatures. This is nearly the exact same process pioneered by Lucasfilm and Industrial Light & Magic. Fortunately, nowadays filmmakers have much easier access to motion control tools instead of needing to build your own. But what he doesn't have access to is the model shop. Instead, he has an inexpensive Millennium Falcon model. The stock paint job wasn't really selling the shot, so I pulled in the help of Bill Duran from Punished Props to give it a once-over. Bill has an entire video of his process of painting and weathering the model, fixing some inaccuracies, filling gaps, and adding a pair of threaded inserts for mounting and rigging. The other interesting part of this video is some of the filming techniques used. The action looks really fast, but it was all filmed at 3 frames per second. This allowed Ryan to use his motion control system to capture slow and smooth shots that captured a natural motion blur, which would add to the sense of scale and speed when sped up. It's a fun set of videos with a ton of great tips. And over on Adafruit, I found this guide by the Ruiz brothers on how to build an overhead camera rig for your photography and filming setup. These can come in super handy if you want to document your maker projects, or if you just have a particular way of making thumbnails for a YouTube series. The Ruiz brothers setup makes use of aluminum extrusion and some 3D printed parts. Corner brackets and T-plates secure the uprights, and these custom printed brackets make it easy to adjust the height. You can also use it to hang seamless backdrops for those perfect photos of your finished projects. It also looks like it should break down fairly easily if you need it to get out of your way when you're not using it. Time for some tips and tools. Lately, I've been hearing a ton of buzz about the M-Lite. This is a 3D printed camera rehousing kit that turns the Canon EOS M into a cinema style camera. The EOS M is special because when paired with the Magic Lantern custom firmware, becomes a cinema grade camera with 5K resolution and 14 stops of dynamic range. The only problem is, because of its form factor, it's not easy to rig for cinematic shooting. The M-Lite was developed by 3D Focus and IMCE, and it's being sold as a kit where you'll need to supply your own EOS M and rehouse it yourself, though they do plan to sell the 3D printed files so you can print your own. It takes a little bit of legwork, but the idea that you can have a cinema grade camera for around $500 seems pretty exciting. Colin Furze released a video with 18 shop tips from his own way of working. If you're tired of philosophical or organizational shop tips that take a ton of discipline to employ, this isn't that. These are just 18 quick tips that are super helpful and you can use straight away. Like how to grind a tiny piece of metal, or how to store a stepladder, how to make a jig for designing cones, and even how to get your hands clean after a day in the shop. There's a lot of specific stuff in here, so you might not be able to use everything, but you're bound to find a few bits of gold in this video. Over on Instructables, I found this guide by Pliskin AJ on how to check to make sure your project is square and how to fix it if it isn't. Most folks know the trick of measuring corner to corner in both directions, making sure they're the same length. He uses that too, but your project can still be out of square if it's twisted. Not only does this guide help you build a square and correct it if it isn't, but also design your projects so if it's a little out of square, it's not a deal breaker. Useful stuff. And finally, if you enjoyed the project from FilmRiot and want to see the original article for that kind of work, check out the Light and Magic documentary series on the Disney Plus streaming service. This is a 6-part series detailing the history and technology behind industrial light and magic, one of the most important visual effects houses in the movie industry. I know it's about filmmaking, but the origins of the company are pretty much the story of what happens when you have way too many smart, creative people all working towards the same goals. It's a celebration of the maker drive and maybe a little bit of wish fulfillment of getting to work with all the best nerds day in and day out. It's a really fun watch. For this week's DigiKey Spotlight, we have another helpful video from Shawn Hymel about PID controllers. PID stands for proportional, integral, and derivative, which isn't exactly helpful in explaining its purpose. PID controllers are abstract systems that manage closed loop systems. Think of them a little like the thermostat in your house. When the ambient temperature in your house drops below the set temperature, it will activate the furnace, warming your house up until the desired temperature is achieved. There's a whole lot more math involved in making use of the sensors and desired output, especially if the input is analog, unlike most home furnaces. Shawn takes you through all the math and then even walks you through some sample code for an example PID controller. All right, and that is gonna do it for this week's show. I hope you enjoyed it and appreciated the deviations into the various themes of this week's show. If you did, leave us a comment, give us a thumbs up, and hit subscribe so you won't miss the next one. As always, great big thanks to DigiKey for making this show possible and to you for watching. Take care, we'll see you soon.